There I am. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Friendship Baptist Church. So good to see each and every one of y'all here tonight. I went to the mailbox today expecting to see a letter in there addressed from Friendship Baptist Church, but Janice didn't send me one having my letter in it, so I decided to come on back and see how you guys been doing. Y'all looking good. But it is so good to be back with y'all tonight. And I know y'all have had a good time already, and I'm looking forward to what God's got in store for us this evening. So we're going to open up with page 46, I'd Rather Be an Old Time Christian. Shake one another's hands, welcome our visitors, spread a little friendship, love, give me a hug, go through so inclined, welcome me back. You may be seated.
to see everybody out tonight. Another night of revival, and we look forward to what God's got in store for us here at Friendship Baptist Church, and we're excited about what the Lord has done. Had a great service this morning and a good time together, and I'll tell you, there's been no lack of good food. Dennis and Rhonda took us out yesterday, and we ate at Giorgio's at Cumming. If anybody's ever ate out there, you know how good that is, and just a great, great time together. And one thing I've learned about our visiting preacher this week, he's got a healthy appetite. he can do all right. And we ate at Randall and Sherry's today, and if you've ever ate at Randall and Sherry Fields, there was enough food there to have fed everybody here, I believe. And, but it was absolutely amazing, and we appreciate that so much. And so y'all have been so good to us, and we thank you for that. But I'm just glad to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad to have a voice tonight.
Yes.
And so we told Nathan that, Lord's willing, we'll give him a little bit of a break tonight. Y'all have to put up with me for a few minutes. Just pray that my voice will stay strong and we'll be able to get across what the Lord has placed on my heart. But I do feel like I need to let you know something tonight. Many of you already know. I think word gets around pretty quick. But Bethany Baptist Church in Milton, Georgia, the first church I ever pastored, has come and talked to my middle son, Caleb, about being their pastor. And so y'all be praying for Caleb and Sierra in this part of their journey. It breaks my heart in one way, but it thrills my heart in another. And to know that he will go and stand in the same pulpit that the Lord gave me the privilege to stand in for 9 years. And so we're I will be quite honest with you. I was joking. I was talking with my wife. I said, it scares me to death. I'm afraid half my congregation's going to Milton. And, but I know that y'all love him. You've loved on him so much. And friendship's been a big part of Caleb's life. He was young when we came here. We're thrilled about that. So just be praying for the church. They haven't officially elected him yet, so... But I don't think that's going to be an issue. They've already told it. They told the church yesterday who they were talking to and all of that. So word is out there. And so I wanted y'all to hear it from us. And just be praying for them and be praying for me and Michelle. It's going to be different. We've been to church together now for, well, all their life. And it's going to be different for us, too. But we know that God's got great things in store for them and for Bethany Church. So just wanted to say that because I know all of y'all will be praying for him. And we'll be trying to get an ordination set up soon. And so just be praying about that as well. And I had actually already talked with Jason about that a little bit. We had talked about some things. And so... we're just believing that God's going to bless in a mighty, mighty way. So thank you for being here tonight. Please, please pray for this service and that God's will be done. And I'd love to see somebody saved tonight, wouldn't you? It'd be a good time for somebody to be saved by the grace of God. And if you'll pray, I believe we will see that very thing happen. We know it's God's will to save. He came to seek and to save those who are lost. So we know it's His will. It's just people has to get their heart willing, repent of their sin, and believe, and just accept His salvation. And I'm telling you, there's nothing like it. Nothing like being an old-time Christian. Amen? Nothing like being an old-time Christian. I'd like to go to the Lord in prayer, and I'm going to ask Brother Chris Chester if he would to take us to the Lord in prayer. Brother Chris.
Yes.
God, and Lord, that we might just go to meet for you tonight, Lord, and that those around and about us, Lord, that might be lost and undone, God, that they might come to know you tonight. They might want a little bit of what they see
this.
Troubles,
he will
hear our faintest cry,
he will
answer by and Just look.
speak into the mic.
About that name. In Matthew 1:21, the angel of the Lord told Joseph about Mary, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Did you know that the name Jesus can be translated as Yahweh saves? The Lord is salvation. He who rescues, delivers, saves. Essentially, Savior. Can you take a second to think about what our Savior had to do to save his people from their sins? He died to set us free. He shed his precious blood on that cross to break our chains, and he did it because his love for us is far greater than we could ever imagine. And as he humbly went to the cross for us, Paul reinforced in Philippians that there is power in the name of Jesus.
Yes,
wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Because of this man with a name like music in my ear, we must follow Ephesians 5, 1 through 2, that which says, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Jesus, sweetest name on earth.
Yeah. never knew the meaning of joy down in my soul. When I was finally knelt, contentment filled my soul like it never felt. Heaven came down, there was glory all around when he saved my soul.
I remember the day
when the Lord saved me, when the Lord saved me.
All of heaven came down.
All of heaven came down.
I was happy and free.
I was happy and free.
Glory filled my soul.
Glory filled my soul. For I knew the Lord had made me whole. I should never forget the day when the Lord saved me. Deep within my heart abides, since the day that Jesus took my sins away. And to heaven I will go, to spend the endless ages while he ever roams, praising his name for the glorious day that he saved my soul.
I remember the day
when the Lord saved me, when the Lord saved me.
All of heaven came down.
All of heaven came down.
I was happy and free.
I was happy and free.
Glory filled my soul.
Glory filled my soul. For I knew the Lord had made me whole. I should never forget the day when the Lord saved me.
I remember the day.
I remember the day when the Lord saved me.
I was happy and free.
I was happy and free.
Glory filled my soul.
Glory filled my soul. For I knew the Lord had made me whole. I should never forget the day when the Lord saved me.
And if it's okay, can we get these kids up here and we do glory, glory, glory? Days of the weeks? The days of the week? Yeah, the days of the weeks?
Yeah.
So, anybody that wants to come and sing, glory, glory, glory. Okay. Y'all do. Come on. And if you know that day, raise your hand high. The day you'll never forget. Or stand up.
Somebody touched me. It was on a Sunday. Somebody touched me. It was on a Sunday. Somebody touched me. It was on a Sunday. Somebody. prepare the ways for you. And a friend who understands everything you're going through. Standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame, there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place?
Bring it all.
Thank you. singing has been extraordinary tonight. Amen? Wonderful, wonderful. I do remember the day that the Lord saved me. I don't remember the day of the week that it was, but I remember the day that the Lord saved me. And it used to bother me when I would go places and they would sing that song, Glory, 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 because I really didn't know when to stand up. So most of the time I just stood up when Michelle stood up. But it still bothered me because I felt like if I didn't stand up, everybody was looking at me and I was, you know, a preacher and everything. And, you know, they're wondering if the preacher, you know, was the preacher not saved or what's going on. But finally I went to a church one time and when they sang Glory, 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 they said, we do it a little different here. They said, we add a verse and say it was on a great day. And so if you don't remember the exact day, that is your verse to stand up. And I felt such relief because I got to stand up on it was on a great day. So after that, I went to Mayfield Baptist Church, and I was helping in revival, and they were going to sing Glory, Glory, Glory. And so I said, can I say something before you sing it? And I told them about that. And I said, so I think we ought to sing it was on a great day. And so they did a verse, it was on a great day, and I was able to stand up. So after that, the rest of that week, every time they would sing that, the song leader would say, well, we're going to sing Glory, Glory, Glory. And we used to sing it a certain way until Ricky came along, and now we've had to change it. And so, anyway, thank you for giving me a verse that, and I noticed Caleb stands up on that verse as well. So I know that there's others, no doubt, that don't remember the exact day, but you know that there was a day. Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you for all the singing. If I can do anything tonight, I would love to just be able to tell you about my Jesus. And you know, and I would for us all tonight just to bring it to the table because that's what he wants us to do. And there's no need for us to hold anything back from him. He's well aware of our faults. He's well aware of our sin. He's well aware of our, you know, everything about us. And so we can't hide anything from him. Y'all agree with that? Amen. Amen. We can't hide anything from him. So we just need to be honest with him tonight. And I hope that we can be honest with him. The Spirit has just overwhelmed me tonight. And I've been able already to shed tears and just to feel his presence in this place. And I'm so thankful for that. And we are so blessed at Friendship Baptist Church. So very blessed. I want to share a verse to begin with out of the 22nd chapter of the book of Ezekiel. The 22nd chapter of the book of Ezekiel. I'm going to be honest with you. I thought I would use this on Sunday along with what I used from Psalm 106 when we talked about the breach. But I didn't, the Lord, for whatever reason, didn't allow that to happen. And I understand now and I know why. Because he wanted me to use this for this service tonight. So in the 22nd chapter of the book of Ezekiel, we're going to read verse 30. 22nd chapter of the book of Ezekiel, verse 30. And when we read this verse, I believe it might be one of the saddest verses in all of God's Word. And I think you'll see why. The Bible says, and Ezekiel records, and this is the Lord speaking to Ezekiel as he put these words down, and I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. Did you hear that? I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. So very sad that they looked for a man to stand in the gap. God sought for a man so that he would not destroy the nation of Israel, and yet he found none. There was none to stand in the gap. I realize Sunday we talked about standing in the breach, filling the breach. Moses did that time and time again for the nation of Israel. No, Moses would intercede on behalf of the people of Israel, and God would turn away His wrath from them and spare that nation. And here in the book of Ezekiel, we find once again that Israel has sinned as they did over and over, time and time again. And God's wrath is about to be poured out on this nation. He's had all He can take. He's not going to take any more. And so He begins to look for a man to stand in the gap. And the Bible says, and Ezekiel records, "But I found none." I didn't find anyone. Why is it that there was not a man to be found to stand in the gap? I went back to the 17th verse of this chapter, and we're going to read some verses here in verse 17 of this 22nd chapter. Listen to what the Bible says. "And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, the house of Israel is to me become dross. All they are brass and tin and iron and lead in the midst of the furnace. They are even the dross of silver. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you are all become dross, behold, therefore, I will gather you into the midst of Jerusalem, as they gather silver and brass and iron and lead and tin into the midst of the furnace, to blow the fire upon it, to melt it, so will I gather you in my anger and in my fury, and I will leave you there and melt you. Yes, I will gather you and blow upon you in the fire of my wrath, and you shall be melted in the midst thereof." I don't know about you, but that doesn't sound very good, does it? We like to talk about, I like to preach about, Nathan likes to preach about the love of God. We like to preach about His grace, and we like to preach about His mercy. And I think it's necessary. But I think it's also necessary that we understand there's a wrathful side of God. And that wrathful side of God will be poured out upon sin. Why? Because God cannot, will not, never has, never will tolerate sin. There had to be a payment for sin. God sent His Son into the world not to condemn it, but that the world through Him might be saved. There had to be the shedding of blood of the Lord Jesus Christ to save us from our sin. But God's wrath must be satisfied. And here, the wrath of God is about to be poured upon the land. And God says to Ezekiel, "I searched out a man to fill the gap. I searched out someone that would stand in the gap so that I would not destroy the land, but I found none." You know what dross is? I looked it up. And this is what dross is. It's something regarded as worthless. It's rubbish. It's the dregs. It's the mineral waste. Listen to this. It's the scum formed on the surface of molten metal. So it's scum. You know what else I found that was interesting? And this tied in with a story. And I don't mean to be gross tonight, but I think this ties in very well. I went for a while and didn't go to the dentist. You know, COVID messed a lot of stuff up. And there for a while, the dentist that I was going to, they would check my blood pressure. And every time I do something like that, my blood pressure goes through the roof. And so sometimes I would go and they'd send me home. They wouldn't even clean my teeth because my blood pressure was too high. So I just kind of gave up on the dentist. I said, well, I'll just brush my teeth regular. I'll floss every once in a while. Everything will be good. So I went about 3 or 4 years and didn't really go to the dentist. And I brushed, you know, regular and all that. But like I say, I flossed every once in a while. But then again, I wouldn't floss so much. And so when I finally broke down and went to the dentist, guess what? It wasn't that my teeth were bad. It wasn't that my teeth were dirty. It was what had got down in there under the gums. And that was bad. And they prodded and poked and prodded and pulled and yanked and put, and I thought they was killing me. And they said, you're going to have a deep cleaning. And I didn't know what a deep cleaning was, but I will raise my hand to you tonight and tell you I know what a deep cleaning is now. And you don't want one. You don't want one because it's bad. And you bleed for about 3 or 4 days afterwards. And then you have to go back in 2-3 weeks and they do the other side of your mouth because they won't do it all at one time. And I know now why they won't do it all at one time, because you would die. Your heart couldn't take it. So I thought this was interesting. It gave an example of the word dross. And you know what it said? Listen to this. The gunk between your teeth that comes out when you floss. No one wants it. And it's harmful if it stays there. You see what I'm getting at? The dross, that stuff that I left there for too long that worked its way down in my gums. And it was going to cause me big problems if I didn't get something done about it. And so now, guess what? I'm on an advanced schedule. I have to go a little more often than the normal Joe because they got to make sure my gums is healing up like they're supposed to. And it's all my own stupid fault because I left the dross there that needed to come out, the junk that didn't need to be there. And folks, is it not the same way in our lives today? You know why the nation of Israel was in the shape they were in? Because the Bible said they'd become like dross. They'd become worthless and useless. They were the scum of the earth. And they were supposed to be God's chosen people. What's wrong with that picture today? God blessed Israel not so that they could go around with their chin up in the air and their chest puffed out and talk about how they were God's chosen people. That wasn't it at all. God called the nation of Israel and set them aside because they were supposed to be a blessing to other nations and lead others to Him. What is the purpose of the church today? So we can dress up in a suit and a tie and come every once in a while and say hallelujah, amen, and go home? Or is it to reach a lost and a dying world with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? Is the church today, are we being everything that God wants us to be? There's something called a smelting process, and that's when they take the iron and the metals and they put it in the furnace and it heats it up to a point to where all the impurities come out. And what's left over is the pure metal, the silver or the gold or the tin or the iron or whatever it is. And the more pure it is, the stronger it is. Do we understand that? They got to get all those impurities out. But here's what happens sometimes when you and I as Christians go through the fire. We think God must be upset with us. We don't understand that He's simply doing this to get the impurities out of our life so that we can be everything that He wants us to be. We think He's upset with us, or we think maybe He's just turned His back on us and so we're ready just to give up and quit. Man, this is too hard. Nobody's listening. Nobody cares. And yet we don't realize God sends us through the fire. There's a process to purify us. He wants to get rid of that dross, that scum. And He wants to do it so we can be pure. Pure. Because when we're pure, we can go out and we can win others to the Lord Jesus Christ. That girl, Megan was her name, that worked on me two different times. And bless her heart, she was as gentle as she could be. And they numbed me up as good as they could numb me up. I had to have the needles all stuck around in there, and that hurt pretty bad. And then it still didn't numb it up completely. And she said, well, the fact is, we can't give you enough because you're going to just feel some of it. And boy, she wasn't lying. She wasn't lying. But you see, now I can look back on that. Oh, and get this. You better believe I'm a flosser now. I went and bought me one of them water picks. And you should have seen my kitchen, my bathroom counter and my mirror and everything else. First few times I used that thing, I had the walls wet, the mirror wet, the floor wet. It was a mess. I thought, man, I'm never going to get used to this thing. And then I'd put the pressure up so high, I felt like I was peeling my gums off. And finally, I settled down and got used to it. And now, man, they ain't a day goes by. I use my water pick. And sometimes, guess what? I even use the floss, too. I don't want to go through that again. You understand what I'm saying? I don't want to have to do that again. I want to do whatever I can for my teeth to stay as clean as they can and my gums to stay healthy because I want to keep my teeth. You know what I mean? Sometimes we don't understand. But I want to tell you something. God's got a plan. God had a plan for the nation of Israel, and they just wouldn't listen. They just wouldn't listen. And God sent word by Ezekiel the prophet and said, look, my people's become like dross. They've become the scum. They're supposed to be a holy, separated people, but they've become the scum. They become the dross. They become the leftover. God wanted them to be pure. God wanted them to be holy. God wanted the best. He wants the best for His church tonight. Do we understand that? He wants the best out of you. He wants the best out of me. And you know where it starts? It starts with our relationship with Him. What is your relationship based on? Is your relationship based on an emotion? Is it based on the good time that you had? Is it based on the fact that you go to church? Is it based on the fact that you try to be a good person? If it's based on anything besides Jesus Christ, you based it on the wrong thing. Yeah. Being a member of Friendship Church won't get you to heaven. Right. Being a good person, a little good boy, girl, won't get you to heaven. Tithing, giving you money to church, dropping a few dollars in the offering plate, won't get you to heaven. Giving to charity won't get you to heaven. Jesus Christ will get you there. He is the only way. He is the way. Them old saints of old, they understood that. Men like Tommy Henderson and Hoyt Thompson, Barry Henderson, John Lomas, those men knew that. That's why they preached their heart out. They gave it everything they could. I heard a young preacher say one time, he hadn't been preaching long, but he helped Tommy Henderson in a revival. Some of y'all remember Tommy Henderson. He helped Tommy Henderson in revival, and he said, you know what? He said, this is a fact. He said, I could get up and preach my heart out for 45 solid minutes, preach as hard as I could preach, beg and plead people to come to the altar, and they'd just sit there and look at me. Wouldn't move, wouldn't do a thing. He said, old Tommy Henderson, you get up in the pulpit, say a few words, step down in the pulpit, pop his hands together about twice and say, won't you come? And said they'd just fill that altar up. Amen. Just fill it up. Amen. Oh, Nathan, that somewhere along the way, it would be that way with me and you, where the power of God would be so evident that sinners, listen, the Bible says sinners cannot stand in the congregation of the righteous. What's going on with us today, church? If sinners can come in our midst, lost as lost can be, and go out the doors, lost as lost can be, what is that saying about us tonight? What is it saying? We need to pray, oh Lord, send the power just now, the convicting power of the Holy Spirit. People won't come to Jesus until they're convicted of their sin. People won't come to Him until they know they're lost. And it's our responsibility to point them in the right direction. I sought a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. But I found none. I read a message, an old preacher, and he preached a message about the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. And he talked about how Paul meant when he wrote that it was above all other knowledge. It was the top knowledge you could possibly possess. It didn't matter how smart you were in any other subject. If you didn't have the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, you didn't have anything, because that supersedes it all. Yes. The excellency of the knowledge of Christ. That's what we need to preach today. That's what the church needs to exemplify today. That's what we need to be all about. I looked over at Nathan as they led the songs tonight, and I said, you know, it always thrills me. I said, these young boys get up, and I said, you know, the songs they lead is the very same ones I led when I was a kid, when I was a young boy. They'd ask me to lead a song, and I'd lead them same songs. And Nathan said, you know what? He said, the thing about it is now, he said, they mean more to me. He said, they're richer. And I said, you're exactly right. And if the Lord tarries his coming, Nathan said, it'll be richer for them one day as well. You know why amazing grace still stirs the heart? Because it is amazing grace. You know why we can sing I'll Fly Away with such gusto? Because we know one day we're going to fly away. You know why songs like Let Me Tell You About My Jesus makes my heart soar? Because I ought to want to tell people about my Jesus. Just as Moses stood in the breach, as we talked about Sunday, it's our responsibility as the Church of the Living God to stand in the gap. To stand in the gap. Had someone stood in the gap, the horrors and the things that the nation of Israel went through because of their disobedience. Oh, how they could have been spared so much. Had someone been willing to stand in the gap? Had someone been willing to stand and tell them the truth? Yes, they had the prophets. They had those old men. Man, I'm telling you what, those guys had it rough. We don't know what it's like, but they did. They preached to people that didn't want to hear a word they said. They preached to people, and man, they tried to tell them the truth, and it went in one ear and out the other. And finally, the Lord says to Ezekiel, I looked for somebody, but I didn't find anyone. And now my wrath is going to be poured out on them. Oh, today, church, America needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. I read things about the church, and it seems like in places where the church is persecuted the most, guess what's happening the most? That's where it grows the most. Under severe persecution, it continues to grow. You know why? Because those people don't have anything but Jesus, and they figured out Jesus is enough, and they just want everybody to have him. They want to tell people about their Jesus. They don't want to be considered the scum of the earth. They want people to have the same salvation that they've got. Is that our desire as well? Do we want the world to know about our Jesus? It's amazing to me, and I'll say I'm guilty. I can talk about anything, man. I can talk about deer hunting as long as the day is long. I can. You want to talk guns, you want to talk tractors, you want to talk stuff like that, man, I can talk years off. But when it comes to telling you about my Jesus, sometimes I get kind of quiet. You know, don't want to offend nobody. You know, they probably don't want to hear that anyway. They ain't going to listen. Well, first off, how do we know until we try? How do we know if we don't make the effort? How do we know that we might be the very one at that very opportunity that stands in the gap between someone's eternity, either in heaven or in hell? How do we know? Well, preacher, I'm just not good with stuff like that. Well, let me fill you in on a little something. I'm not either. But God, help us and give us strength and the courage, and help us to remember the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus that surpasses everything else we know. The most important message we have is Jesus. Yes. Jesus. We can be soul winners for Christ, or we can be something regarded as worthless and rubbish. scum formed on the surface of molten metal, that gunk between your teeth that needs to come out when you floss, that shouldn't be there, but if it's there long enough, it's going to cause you trouble. It's going to cause you trouble. You know what that comes down to in the life of a believer? We can dabble in sin all we want to and think we're getting by with it, but I'm going to tell you something. It's sooner or later going to cause us trouble. It just is. What is the old saying? You can be sure your sins will find you out. Israel's sins had found them out. And the Lord was looking for somebody to stand in the gap. But he said, they've all become dross, Ezekiel. I looked for one, but I didn't find any. They've all become worthless and useless. Scum of the earth. And yet they're supposed to be my chosen people. Isn't that sad? Isn't that sad? Isn't it sad today that the church has splits and controversy over whether a boy's a boy and a girl's a girl? Whether men ought to marry men or women ought to marry women? Isn't that something that the church is in a turmoil over that? There shouldn't be any question among God's people.
Right. Amen. Right.
I mean, there's certain, I'm telling you what's the truth, people. And to say that they're not coming after our young people, they're coming at them with everything they've got.
Yes, they are.
They're coming at them with everything they've got. And it frightens me. The things that I'm being told that's going on in elementary and middle school and high school and the stuff that's being pumped out of our institutions of higher learning. It's troubling.
Yes.
A lot of people think they've got a lot of knowledge and they're experts in this field and that field. But I want to tell you something. There ain't no expert ever overcome this right here. You know, the only thing that's going to stand when the world's on fire? God's Word.
Right.
And I'm not talking about this Bible I'm holding in my hand. This Bible I'm holding in my hand will burn up with the rest of it. But God's Word that lives in the heart of His people, it'll never be done away with.
Right. Amen.
Doesn't matter how hard the government tries. Doesn't matter how hard they come at us. God's Word will stand. Always has, always will. So, are we going to stand in the gap? Are we going to be considered the dross of society? The dregs, the scum of the earth. The church ought to be standing in the gap, people. Amen? And not just the pastors and the Sunday school teachers and the music leaders. I'm talking about everybody. Every one of us that knows Jesus Christ as our Savior. Stand in the gap. We might just be the difference between somebody spending eternity with us in heaven or spending eternity in hell. You might be the difference. I might be the difference.
Yes.
Do we understand that? Do we understand it? Well, I hope you remember something about this message aside from the fact that I didn't go to the dentist for 3 or 4 years and my teeth got in bad shape. If that's all you got out of it, then I messed up. I hope it made sense. And I hope that we understand. The point is, there's work to be done. The church has a responsibility. Are we going to fulfill it?
Yes.
Are we going to be the light in a dark and dying world? Are we going to be... are we going to face the fire that we're sure to go through so that we can be purified and all that dross will be swept away? Are we just going to moan and groan and be satisfied with the status quo and this is just the way it is nowadays and we're just going to do the best we can? Will it be said about Friendship Baptist Church one day, by the Lord, that I went down there and I looked for somebody to stand in the gap at Friendship Baptist Church, but I didn't find none? Why not? Well, because they become like dross. You say, preacher, you've been awful ugly. No, listen, I'm talking to myself tonight too. I preach to myself as much as I do anybody. It don't feel good, does it? I don't like to be called scum. I don't want to be called the dross. I don't want to be called that gunky stuff that gets stuck between your teeth that you have to floss out. It's not what I want to be. I want to be found standing in the gap, don't you? Isn't that what we're supposed to be about? Standing in the gap. God told Ezekiel, I looked for somebody that would make up the hedge. I looked for somebody to stand in the gap, but I didn't find one. I didn't find one. Will you be the one that stands in the gap tonight? Is there somebody you've got on your heart that you just feel is lost and your heart's breaking for them? You may be the one that just needs to slip an arm around them and say, everything okay? Are you lost? You need to be saved? See them come to this altar. Pray and ask the Lord to forgive them. Come into their life and save their soul. See that countenance change. See that smile on their face. Hear them say the words, Jesus, save me. And you know that you stood in the gap. Wouldn't that be wonderful tonight? Wouldn't that be good? While we stand together and sing, you follow the Lord. Nathan, come on out with me if you will. You follow the Lord.
Page 375 in the church hymnal.
Somebody's going to go home and somebody's going to ask them, well, how was meeting at Friendship tonight? You're going to say, well, the preacher said I was the scum of the earth. If you tell them that, you're telling them a lie. It's not what I said. I said, I don't want to be and you don't want to be. That's what God's people had become. God's word said it. I read it to you. God's word said it. That's what they had become. And God said, I just need somebody to stand in the gap. I just need somebody to fill in the hedge. I thought of the hedges in Sanford Stadium where the Georgia Bulldogs play. Go Dogs. I've seen them hedges. Thought about a break in those hedges. God says, I need somebody to fill that hedge. I need somebody to fill that gap. Will we be the ones? Will Friendship Church be the ones that steps in? There's lost people out there that needs Jesus all around this community. We are a blessed congregation. Y'all agree? We are a blessed congregation. God has blessed us so abundantly. Blessed us so abundantly. And here's the deal. We don't work to be saved. We work because we are saved. We know that the moment that you add anything to grace, it's not grace anymore. If you say, yes, you need to believe in Jesus, but you're still going to have to do this, this, and this, then you know, I'll go a step further. Listen here, and I hope I don't confuse anybody by saying this, but I can't say, Nathan, if you'll just believe in Jesus Christ and get saved, then everything, but then you need to get baptized, and then you'll be truly saved. I've added baptism to salvation. And it ain't right. Y'all remember a man that died on the cross hanging right beside the Lord Jesus Christ? He died on the cross right beside him. And in that moment, in his dying moment, he knew his time was up. And he knew he needed to do something. And he looked over at his buddy over there and he said, look, you and me's up here because we deserve it. We've done wrong. We've sinned. We've broke the law. We're dying because we deserve to die on this cross. But this man here in the middle, he's not done one thing. Not done nothing. And he said, Lord, will you remember me when you come into your kingdom? Right there on that cross, Jesus looked over at that man and said, this day you'll be with me in paradise. He didn't take him down off the cross and baptize him. There wasn't time. But he baptized him with the Holy Spirit of God, filled him right there on that cross, and he took his dying breath and went into the very presence of the Lord. And we'll see that man one day, and that's something. What did he do to earn it? I heard a man preach a message one time, and he talked about it. He said, think about that man on the cross, that thief on the cross when he got there. They said, what is your qualifications? Why are you here? And he said, I have no idea. Then why are you here? And he said, all I know is that man on the middle cross said I could come. That man on the middle cross said I could be here, and here I am. The only reason I'm going to heaven is because I've been saved by the grace of God. The only reason I'm going to be there is because Jesus saved my soul. The only reason you're going to be there is because Jesus saved your soul. We ought to shout it from the rooftops. It's Jesus, it's Jesus, it's Jesus. What about it tonight? Do you need to be saved? You need to be saved. You've got time tonight, right now. I cannot guarantee you another minute. I can't. If I told you, I'll guarantee you, you can come back tomorrow night and you can just make things right. I'd be a liar. Because I can't guarantee you anything like that. We might be here and we might not. You might be here and I might not. Don't know. Don't know. But you've got opportunity now. I do know that. So we're going to sing another verse. If you need to come and be saved, don't put it off. Just come. Just come.
On the second.
Thank you.
Anyone else need to come? An altar of prayer. An altar of prayer.
Page 81. I surrender all.
Nathan, you got anything, buddy? Are you sure? Quiet. Quiet. Thank y'all so much for being here tonight. Thank you for freedom in the altar. Thank you for freedom in the pulpit. Freedom in the music. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Thank you for being a part of it. And we pray that it just grows from here. And when I say grow, listen, don't take that wrong. that I necessarily, oh, I'd love to see the house packed. Sure I would. Any pastor would. When I say grow, I'm talking about if we that are coming are growing in the Lord and we're being revived, then I'm going to tell you something. Then we don't have to worry about the other part. Amen. That part's not in our, it's not in our power and control anyway. We have to be obedient. If we're obedient, if we'll be the one that stands in the gap, God does the rest. Always has. And I have no reason to doubt that he won't continue to do so. So thank you so much for being here tonight. Keep coming, keep praying, keep seeking God's will. As I always say, go praying, come back praying. And I believe God's got more great things in store for us. We'll be here 11 o'clock in the morning. If you can be here, come and be with us. And there's just something sweet and precious about those morning services. And we'd love to have you come and be a part of that as well. So, yes, Wednesday. Yes, thank you, Janice. Wednesday is our church day here. And we sometimes call it our senior day. And we'll have lunch in the fellowship hall, and we want you to come and be a part of that. And we know that's always good. It'll be a good time, and so please, please keep that in your thoughts and prayers and come and be a part of that if you possibly can. I know that you will be blessed for being here. Also, remember our youth night will be on Friday night, and Caleb will be preaching, and we're looking forward to that. Keep praying for Les. I haven't told him yet when. He's just patiently waiting, and he's always willing. He's never turned me down. And so y'all pray for Les. I know the Lord's going to work that out. And so I'm excited, aren't you? It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. There was something else I was going to mention, and now I can't. I'm drawing a blank. What am I forgetting? Is there anything about the music I'm supposed to be saying? It's going to be good. How about that?
All right.
Okay. Awesome. That sounds good. All right. Let's do this again. Let's throw our hands up real high. If you've been glad to be here tonight, say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.